Okay, so today we will continue our discussion on our stochastic linear bandits. So in the last class, we just argued that if you make certain assumption about my confidence set and about the mean rewards and also about the norm of my context or norm of my decision element, we came up with a method to give a regret bound, right? So can anybody tell me what was that bound finally we derived last time? So that said, my regret band is upper bounded by what? 2 times. Okay. So today what we'll do is we'll just try to understand if at all it is possible to come up with a confidence set which satisfies our assumption. What was our assumption? We said that there exists some set CT which we could define it as theta such that norm of theta hat minus theta is beta t with respect to beta minus t. We say that such that theta belongs to star with high probability for all t. So I wanted that it every time you have this confidence set, we are henceforth will call it as confidence ellipsoids. So this is because now it is like a ball around centered around this point theta hat. So now the question is, such a thing exists. If at all I can define some beta t for which this holds. So today we can again, before we going to state it formally like such a beta t exists, we are again going to make further more assumptions and now try to see that if at all it is possible under a bit more restricted cases. Okay, then we will see that how to relax that restricted case to a more general case where we can get such a beta. So the more general case requires us to get into something bit more sophisticated like martingales and mixture methods. We'll not just go into that. What we'll just talk about is some basic ideas and just point out where the method of mixtures and the martingales may have to be used. Okay, but just we'll try to get a sense of how this beta t can exist. Okay. Okay. To understand this, we are further going to make a couple of assumptions before we see how it looks like. We are going to first set lambda equals to 0. That is, there is no regularization. Okay. Before I write this. So how did I find my theta hat? Theta hat we find by minimizing a least square, regularized least square function, right? So what was that function? We defined a function which was so this was our loss function we defined and we tried to minimize it over theta. And what did this give us? So this gave us theta. If you just minimize this, this is argmin of struggle. So rd of my lt theta just turned out to be vt lambda inverse summation rd times d of s s 1 to 2. You already observed, right? This is going to be the solution. So what I mean by, so earlier I had just defined Vt. What was the Vt matrix? So lambda I plus some outer product, sum of outer products, right? But that was a function of lambda. That depends on which lambda I chose. So that's why I made this a function of lambda here. So this Vt lambda is nothing but and this S is going to be 1 to capital T. Okay, now let us try to slightly simplify this. What is this estimate we have gotten here? This quantity here, so this is going to do it only till T minus 1, and then at time T, this is what my loss is going to be look like, okay. Now my theta t hat just, so I am just replacing my vt lambda function here. Vt lambda is lambda I plus d of s transpose s equals to 1 to t times. Now what is my rs function here? What is my rs? What is rs here? Reward that I observed in round s, right? And how was that? Rs is the arm I played in a product theta star plus the sub-Gaussian noise. So this is the noisy version of the reward I got in round S. So this is simply the reward sample I observed in round S. So let me replace that quantity over there. So what this gives me here, if I just replace RS by that quantity, that is DS and this is multiplied by my quantity ds. So now before I start further simplifying these things and see how my confidence ellipsoids are going to look like, I am going to make a couple of assumptions now, simplifying assumptions, okay. First thing, I am going to assume the case that there is no I am going to assume lambda equals to 0. That is the case corresponding to no regularization. Second, independent so I am going to assume that this noises here are actually independent sub-Gaussian noises. So earlier in the original setup, how this noise term is assumed to be? It is conditionally sub-Gaussian, but now we are just assuming that they are all sub-Gaussian and they are independent. So these are my simplified third point, we are assuming that this d1, d2, all the way up to dt are chosen without the knowledge of so this was the r1 r2 all the way up to r3. So what is that we are assuming? First, okay, we are assuming that okay, there is no regularization. That means if there is no regularization here, the thing is this inversion may be not well defined. Okay, but if we had this regularization lambda greater than 0, this inversion was always well defined. But let's ignore that fact. So let's set this lambda to be 0, and then we are going to say that my eta s are all sub Gaussian, then they are independent. The third point, this is the very bad assumptions as we are making. We are just saying that the arm played in till round t, their selection is made without the knowledge of r1 r2 r2 rt. That means we are right now saying my algorithm is kind of not adaptive, right? So every time I chose my arm, it depended on actually what I have played previously, which arm I am played, and what is the corresponding reward I got for that. But now we are saying when I making this assumption, like basically I am ignoring the reward I have observed so far and then making a choice of arm. Okay, that means we are kind of decoupling the dependency of the arm I chose in round t on the observations I have made so far. This is actually not true, but let's say we are making this assumption. So when we had our setup, if you have to learn, we have to make sure that we are going to choose the arm I am going to play in the next round based on what observations I have made, right? But as I said, that makes things complicated to analyze. That's why we will make this simplifying assumption. Okay, let's try to analyze. So now let's try to follow up the sequence of analysis how it goes. Then we will see that what we actually wanted. We just now, as of now, our focus is to see that will I be able to come up with such a set which contains my theta star with high probability for every t. Okay, so the steps we are going to go through, it is going to be certain sequence of manipulation. Just follow this manipulation, we will arrive at this step at some point. Okay, so now first we are going to look at this quantity here. So what is this quantity basically? Theta hat is your estimate in round t, theta star your true parameter. So theta t hat minus theta star is the error you are making in that round. But what this is basically telling is the projection of this r s x on this difference. Okay, so instead of x, let me just call it d, because we are denoting my decision points as d. These are all vectors. Now what is this quantity? This quantity is nothing but d, and now I am going to replace my theta t hat by whatever I have, by making this lambda to be 0. So this will give me what? This will give me summation s equals to 1 to t ds ds transpose inverse of this summation, this quantity over here, s equals to 1 to t . So what I will now do is, so I am just substituting this quantity for theta theta hat here, what I will do is I will do this, I will pull this ds inside, so that will give me I have just replaced the value of theta hat star from this equation here and just brought in this ds inside this. So now if you see this, if I just simplify this d, if I pull this matrix inside, this theta star is constant, that is fixed. Now if I multiply this quantity here, this first term with this, that will give me an identity. So, okay, so let me write this little more. So I have just expanded this inner product here. Okay. So now you see that this quantity gets matrix and I am multiplying by inverse, so they get cancelled. And now what remains is theta star. This theta star will get knocked off with this single theta star I had. So finally, what remains for me is this projection term here. To d times well, why did I write minus here? This should be plus, right? This quantity here S equals to 1 to 3 df transpose, and this is still minus 1 here, and then what remains for me is this quantity here, summation ds into theta s. Okay. So this is just I got after my simplification. Yeah. Yeah. So in this case, yes. That's why this makes sense. We are just assuming that if my lambda has been positive, that would have been always the case. But now I am forcing, let my lambda equals to 0 and trying to assume that that holds, okay. And now just let me, just to make that more explicit, let me write it as Vt of 0. So this Vt is 0 is nothing but this entire quantity. Just simplifying this further, what I had is, this is the inner product between these two. So this is between S1 to T Now if I just take s equals to 1 to t, I can further write it as d times dt of 0 1 inverse times this guy ds here into dS. I have just simply manipulated this, like you just notice that everything is fine. Like if you just take the inner product of this, right, this is inner product of d with this matrix and ds, and now that is summed over all s equals to 1, but I have just pulled the sum out and I'm just writing it like this. Okay, by doing what I have basically done is this projection of my arm d in the on this error term, I have written it in nothing but a linear combination of the noise terms. Ns is noise term, right? Ns is the one sub Gaussian noise. And what is this? So this is it is multiplied by some weight, which is nothing but the inner product of these two quantities, and that is some weight. And now this is noise. So what I have basically done is this quantity is nothing but a weighted sum of the sub Gaussian noise, and if I want to bound this quantity, I now has to bound this weighted sum of the sub Gaussian noise. Okay, so now suppose let's say I am interested in how big this quantity is. Okay, so suppose let's say I wanted to ask the question, okay, probability that d times theta t minus theta star is greater than let's say some number. We'll see why I'm using this number, but let's say I'm interested to know whether it is larger than this number. So I'm now dropping the 0, I'm simply writing Vt inverse here. Square log 1 minus delta. So now that I have written this quantity is same as this quantity, now this probability is nothing but probability that s equals to 1 to t d Vt inverse this quantity being greater than or equals to okay. So now what I have, that this quantity is weighted sum of the sub Gaussian noise, and I am now asking the question, what is the probability that this quantity exceeds this value? How you are what result you are going to apply to find this? So we have already bounded how the tails of sub Gaussian looks like, right? So let's try to apply that here. Okay, is this quantity, entire quantity here, is a sub Gaussian? So if it is sub Gaussian, with that parameter, so we had, if x1 is sigma 1 sub Gaussian, and x2 is let's say sigma 2 sub Gaussian, what is x1 and x2 are like? So we are using only sigma 1 or sigma 1 square for.
Sigma 1.
So then this is like
sigma 1 square.
Sub Gaussian, right? So now eta s is what? 1 sub Gaussian. But now it is multiplied by some number. If x1 is sigma 1 sub Gaussian, if I am going to multiply it by some constant c, what is c x1 is like? It is like distributed like mod c sub Gaussian. Now what is this quantity is like? So this is going to be sigma Gaussian, sorry, this is going to be sub Gaussian with what parameter? Right. So this weights are going to be, so initially it was 1 sigma Gaussian. Now each term in this summation is going to be this much time multiplied sub Gaussian, and now if I want to find the sub Gaussianity of this sum, it is nothing but square root of sum of each one of them. Okay, fine. Now I know that this quantity is sigma sub Gaussian with some sigma. Now I want to bound this quantity to be upper is at least this much. How to find that? So let's say, so if some x is, let's say x is, or let's say x1 is sigma 1 sub Gaussian. What is this probability? We have discussed this, right? We have this probability. What is this quantity is like? Upper bounded as exponential of, there is no n here, there is only one random variable considering, that is sub Gaussian. What is this quantity is like? Minus, was there any 2? I am only looking at one sided, right? Not two sided. So this is simply epsilon square divided by 2 sigma 1 square. So we had already discussed this, right? When we talked about a set of concentration inequality. Now let's say this x1 corresponds to this quantity over here, and this epsilon corresponds to this quantity over here. Okay, notice that I can treat this quantity here as a constant because the way I am making my assumption. Okay, so let's say whatever I have observed so far, right, these are all the random quantities, but I am not making my decision based on these random quantities. I am just playing some arms in every round according to some, and I have to also have to be specific that they are chosen deterministically. Yes, they are chosen without knowing what are this random quantity, and also that when I choose them, I am not choosing randomizing my choices. In every time I am going to choose something deterministically. For example, one strategy could be, okay, I am going to choose my arms in a round robin fashion. In the first round I choose D1, in the second round I choose D2, the third round I choose C3, and after I exhaust all of them, then I will come back and choose. Let us assume that that is one such deterministic case where you have just ignored what has been happened and you have been just simply choosing. Let us see, if I apply this, what is that I am going to get? So what is sigma 1 for me? Sigma 1 for me is nothing but the sum of the squares of these two. Okay, let me see. So now this quantity summation d vt inverse ds s equals to 1 to t. This is what? This is like Is this correct? Into 1, right? Because each eta s is 1 sigma Gaussian. So because of that, I only have to worry about it. Okay. So what I did, I have messed up this. This is only d here. So now let's go back to that. Now because of that, let me write it here. Probability that I'm just repeating that quantity there. This being greater than 2 times so this probability should be what? This should be upper bounded by, I am now just going to apply this quantity here. What is epsilon for me? Epsilon for me is this quantity over here. So I am going to get exp epsilon is, so after doing this square I am going to get 2 times and there is of course log, there is a minus here because of this minus, log 1 by delta, and what is this quantity here 2, what is sigma 1 square? Sigma 1 square is this entire quantity for me, that is so, and this is a square term here. So now if you see that this cancels, what remains here for me is only exp minus log 1 by delta, and what is that quantity is? It is just delta. So now let us try to understand this. What we are able to argue is, if you are going to look at this quantity, which is nothing but the projection of my decision on the error term being larger than this quantity is very small, that is it is upper bounded by delta. So what we are just showing is this projection will not be larger than this quantity, okay, and that depends on this whatever the delta parameter we have chosen. Okay, now we want to now convert it into whatever this result we have. Now we want to convert it into the case where how to come up with this decision set, right? So let's see. So let's say, so this is one part we have shown. So what we have shown is now this is less upper than equals to delta. So we have this part. Now we want to translate. So in my confidence set, if you recall, whatever the CT I had the terms like, so I need to first now try to get how does this term look like, okay. So what is the probability? So what do you want? We want this happening for, if it happens, if I consider a set which satisfies this condition, I want to show that my theta star contains this with high probability, right. So now whatever we have shown here, now try to connect that with this quantity theta t hat minus theta star. And now instead of theta, I want to specifically want to show that if I take theta star, this will also satisfy this condition. That is why that theta is contained in that. So now let's take my theta star here, and now let's try to connect whatever we have with this quantity. Okay, now just let me take this theta here. I think this is theta minus 1. So this can be written as theta t half some y. I will tell you what is this y, and okay, or maybe just can directly write it as into v t half into theta t hat minus theta star, this whole divided by theta t hat minus theta star comma theta t hat theta star. So do you agree that if I take this in the product, this is exactly equals to this? So what is this? This is simply Vt matrix, right? Just take. So, and the denominator is a constant. Okay, so now if you are going to take the transpose of this quantity, this is this quantity transpose into Vt multiplied by this quantity. So this is nothing but what? So the numerator is transpose Vt transpose, but that is symmetric matrix, so I do not care about this. Then theta hat minus theta star, this whole quantity divided by theta t hat minus theta star, right? But numerator is nothing but the squared quantity of the denominator. Where? Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Right, right. Numerator is nothing but the squared quantity of the denominator. That's why we get it back.